Thank you very much for attending and taking time off your busy schedules. I'd also like to thank Jenna Clifford's team and for hosting and sponsoring this morning's event. Thanks, Sonia and Rhino. And obviously it helps us as an NGO to have a sponsored event. We don't have to waste money on building rents and stuff. So while Thomas is hooking up from Germany, let me just quickly introduce you from us left side here, Chris de Bruno Austin, and from Kashugu. He's also director of Now or Never African Wildlife Trust. Petronell's with Care for the Wild Africa, which is the biggest orphanage in Africa at the moment. It's outside Nelspruit. I'm Dex Kotzer, by the way, I think everybody knows me now. And Dr. Jan Marais, Saving the Survivors. And Arie van Deventer, who started the first orphanage back in 2012, first orphanage in Africa. So I think I'm going to carry on as far as Thomas, because he knows all of this. So just to give you a bit of background, back in October 2015, all of us sat together with Thomas as a Google representative, and we conceptualized how we can work as NGOs together. Globally, conservation is very polarized, same in South Africa, same in East Africa, and we looked at how we can combine our forces. You know, something like Dr. Marais here works closely with private rhino owners and reserves, and certainly with the orphanages as well, with that expertise, and he'll give you some background just now when I pass on the mic to everybody. So we looked at what we can do. We know that South Africa has lost in the region of about 6,000 rhinos since the poaching crisis started. And we also know that there's not enough orphans that survive the poaching incidences. And we also realize that elephant poaching is also going to hit South Africa and Kruger National Park, exactly like it's what's happened with the poaching of the rhinos. So with two existing orphanages that were inundated with the care for private rhinos owners as well as the reserves around the country, Ari will tell you, for instance, there that if a rhino owner hasn't got the funds to bring an orphan to the orphanage, it's not about that. Like, it's free medical care. Just bring it in, let's just save the rhino orphan, because we're losing so many. And, you know, currently we're sitting in the last 7-8 days, we've lost, South Africa's lost 23 rhinos, which is horrific. In the last 3 or 4 days, over 100 horns have been confiscated in Vietnam, Hong Kong, and Thailand. They discovered 100 pieces, 100 horns last night. And we all know what happened to the Tula Tula orphanage, which is a very sad and very depressing to hear that the staff were sexually abused and assaulted. And then we had the French zoo that lost a rhino. In Kenya, another big tusker, Johan can tell you also about the big tuskers in East Africa, he's written 2 books on it, but another of roughly 25 big tuskers left, another one died from a poison arrow 2 months ago, and that broke the news 2 weeks ago. It's a mindset that needs to change around the world. It's not just all about conservation. It's a mindset that has to change. Ethics have to change around the world with people globally. And we've come together to not get involved in the politics of conservation. We're on the ground working to save these orphans and pulling our resources and our networks together and saying, what do we need? So Chris will also speak to you just now about their involvement with his company Kashugu and supporting Care for the Wild Africa. But essentially we want to have a big impact, and for that we need corporates worldwide to support this initiative. Our main aim is to rescue orphans as soon as we can. Their threats are drought, you know, not being able to feed themselves after a poaching incident, facing hyenas, facing lions. Petronell's had rhino orphans that have survived for a few days after a poaching incident, but then didn't make it because they were too brutally attacked by the hyenas as such. So our whole thing is the quicker you can get the rhino orphan out of the hotspots, and Kazovac them out. So the smaller rhinos, up until around about 300 kilos, we can use helicopters to Kazovac them out quickly. And then it's the rehabilitation, which is not only the aftercare, but immediate medical care that needs to be done. And once a rhino gets to the age of roughly 3 years, we can release them back. And we currently have two reserves in excess of 30,000 hectares where they can be released, where there's proper security. And we also want to do the education side, looking at rural education in areas like west of Kruger National Park. You've got a 180-kilometer strip. And with Unearth Africa, we did some conservation education 2 weeks ago. And very interesting how these young kids live next to the parks, but they've never seen an elephant, they've never seen a rhino, they've never been on a game drive. So it's really, our thing is rescue, rehabilitation, release, and education. And I just want to show a short clip there. Welcome, Thomas. Thomas is online, and Thomas is sitting in Europe at the moment, and I'll pass on to him. So Thomas is supporting from Google's side.
So there are different programs that Google is doing in terms of supporting various conservation efforts around the world. There are some standard programs which Google supports. Many programs are known under the name Google Grants. And within this program, charities get access to different Google solutions. So a classical thing is advertising on Google itself. So if people in the world search around conservation, they search for elephants, they search for rhinos, that we can provide them the right information. So we provide here privileged access to different charities around the world so that they can get these access for free. Next to advertising, there are also other programs connected to YouTube. There are also other programs connected to using stuff like Google Email, or Google Docs, or any other server infrastructures, which charities get for free. So this is all known under the name Google for Nonprofits. This is one piece that Google has worked in the past with different organizations which are attending this event. For the Now and Never African Wildlife Trust, we'll also cooperate based on these existing programs, but we'll also continue to evaluate any other new solutions where we think that we can have probably even a bigger impact. So depending how the operations will go and where we see they can provide value, we'll always investigate if we can do something more to save as many as possible.
So I'd like to now switch over to everybody that is on the board of Now and Ever African Wildlife Trust, and obviously also beyond their own NGOs. Interesting is that all of us got sort of started post-2012, so it's a whole bunch of new NGOs doing on-the-ground work. With this video, maybe Chris and Petronelle, that was in your area and that you guys took 8 days to find this, can you maybe, I think, give us a background on where you see Care for the Wild of Africa with Now and Ever Wildlife Trust and the work that you do, and just a bit of background, both of you.
Yes, I think I just want to tell them a little bit of, everyone wants to know what happened to that calf now, I'm sure of that. And then Chris can talk a little bit about the big picture. If you have a look at that calf and you get the calf quick enough, it's easy to then work with the wounds, and actually a healing program is so much easier. And it, like you can see, she's quite a big calf. So lately, we're not only getting, if we say a baby, it's not always a baby that you can have on your lap. It sometimes is that baby is 300 kilograms. And I'm sure Ari will also say, this is quite a challenge then with the places where you keep them in, the night bomas, the fitness of your personnel, how quick they can jump out of a boma if needs be, and all that. So with her specifically, that with the wound healing and so on that Dr. Johan helped with, we were healing her in about 3 weeks. That gun wound was completely gone. It looks like the poachers tried to also kill her, but shot against the silencer. And at the moment, she's with a surrogate cows. And this is the first for us, and the first for South Africa, or Africa, as you say, where the baby will come out of a herd of animals and come drink, and the surrogate cows will take them back into the herd. Even for me that's been working in conservation for the last 20 years, it's absolutely amazing to see that that can happen, that that imprint and so on are not that big on those animals, and that you can successfully release them. For us it was quite a surprise, because we didn't know if this will work when we introduce her to a herd of eight other animals, big animals, not small animals, and wild animals. And she came out and she drinking and go back, and the cow will wait there, and a big bull by the name of Donald will stand there and just escort her back into the herd. For me, that's amazing to see, I must be honest with you.
Thanks. Yeah, we've been going for 3.5 years now, and we've done a lot of rescues. Thanks to Kashuga, which I'm part of, we've used we've got a fleet of helicopters, UEs, and R-44s and jet rangers, and we've always been able to call upon them when they're available. So we've rescued literally from a fully grown black rhino bull that broke out of Bululi, and we assisted in slinging it back into the reserve. We've moved animals in the back of helicopters. We've done all sorts of things that had ad hoc to the at Care for Wild's really well situated, quite close to the Kruger and the APNR. So we've had a lot of animals through there. The challenge has been is that to find funding. We've never had a dedicated budget for it. So we never say no. If there's a call, we go. And then we look for cash. So now or never in the future for us is really important, because we plan to have a helicopter on standby 24/7, to start with one and grow it across the country. The big challenge is animals get shot, and in the past, the focus has always been on catching the poachers. So you get to the crime scene, the police do their work, they're following up on the poachers, and they forget that golden hour or two on the calf. And because they're in a big five, most of the animals are in big five areas, they get killed by rhino, by things like lion and hyena, or they're very badly damaged in many cases. So for us, it's really critical that we can actually raise the funding and have a dedicated helicopter 24/7 that responds to every single incident when it happens. So the normal operation carries on, but we go and have a look and see if there's a baby. If it's a bull, of course there's not, but if it's a cow, we follow up and see if the animal's there and wherever it is, and then rescue it. And in that way, if you look at the numbers, it's frightening. Petronelle always says, they shoot a cow and they shoot a calf, but you actually lose three. Or in instances, you find a cow that's in calf and she gets shot, the calf dies, and there's a calf at foot. And if you don't save that calf, you lose three. So it's really, really critical. And we're getting to the point. We've gone past the tipping point. We have to save all the orphans. Every single one is gold now. White and black even more. The black rhino are really, really critically endangered. And then, of course, with Care for Wild, we don't just save them. We put them through a process. And at the moment, we've got animals that are 6 years old that are actually back into the wild. They're free-ranging, and hopefully we're breeding shortly. So that's pretty much what our vision is. And to turn the area into a big area, 85,000 hectares is the plan.
We basically specialize in are going out and rescuing and treating all these rhino that has either been shot, snared, or really badly disfigured, where half their faces have been hacked off. We do between 80 and 100 animals per year, and our success rate, depending on how bad it is around about 70-75%. The biggest drawbacks we have, or complications currently, is still with gunshot wounds. Most of the ones we find where the faces have been hacked off really badly, we can actually heal those cases. And in almost 99% of cases, it takes quite a while, a year and a half, but they can actually do very well after that. Everything we've learned from Hope, and I don't know if you guys remember Hope, we've learned so much with Hope over the last year and a half, that currently we're treating, for instance, a bull near Lanseria, which is called Saya, and he's, you know, Hope has healed about 75% in a year and a half. Saya has healed 75% in about 5 months, okay? So I want to add with, you know, what Chris said, that if you look at the amount of rhinos left in the world, white and black, I think it's absolutely imperative to try and rescue and treat and heal every single rhino we come across now. If you, for instance, treat a young calf that's a heifer, or if we get to a rhino like Hope, which has only been old, about 6 years old, you're not only saving one animal. Once you put that animal, as Chris said, into the wild, that cow can potentially have 5 to 6 calves after that. So you're not only saving one animal, you're saving potentially 6 to 7 animals, all right? And people tend to forget, to actually forget that. So we're quite excited to be part of this, and to fall under Now or Never. Well, I think we should put our differences and politics aside and work together as one large NGO, and make use of the strengths in every single one we have here to actually save rhino, but not only rhino, any endangered species, which is currently obviously the biggest threat is on rhino and elephant, and I can assure you guys, the rest is going to come, like lion and wild dog and everything else.
You know what's very important here is that everybody here cares for the animal. It's not about politics, it's not about egos, it's about the animal, and that's the important thing. When we started the Rhino Orphanage, Pete, 5 years ago, between Pete and myself, we ran around the whole country and were successful at times and unsuccessful at other times in raising funds to build that place. While we were still building the Rhino Orphanage, we got our first calf, and he had a rectal prolapse, and we had to send him to Onderstepoort. And this is where I met this gentleman on my left. Johan Marais treated him successfully, strangely enough. And I've known Pietro Nell for many, many, many years. And all this time that we've had the Rhino Orphanage, Dex is also on the board of directors of the Rhino Orphanage. And for the last couple of years, we've all been working together. We phone each other, we get advice from each other. And it is now time that we work together on an official basis. Because I've always said it, one person, one organization, not even one country, can save these animals. We have to take hands together. and do it as a combined unit. Because I've got no skills, but left of me, there's incredible skills right down to the bottom of the table. And if we can utilize all these skills and bring in more people and more organizations, we can save the rhino and we can save the elephant and everything else that is going to be attacked by poachers in the future. So that is why it's so important that we have the support of everyone. Otherwise, we will not save the animals. And that's why we are here, nothing else.
On behalf of the Tsavo Trust, it's not here because they're quite far away, and Richard Moller started the Tsavo Trust in Tsavo, an area that's larger than Kruger National Park. And we included the Tsavo Trust looking after the big Tuskers. There's less than 25 left in the world. Tsavo has nowadays, I think, 6 or 7 left. And there are also quite a lot of emerging Tuskers. Those are elephants that still have a good 20, 30 years to go. And in their lifetime that are, you know, if they survive, to become big Tuskers. Because the problem is the gene pool gets shot out in all the countries. And so we've included the Tsavo Trust that do phenomenal work flying, and they use aircraft as well. And they fly about 80, 90 hours a month in the Tsavo area. And since 2012, there was a stage where they dropped poaching was over 50%. So the Tsavo Trust is also, we're looking at Kruger. DA mentioned that 46 elephants were poached last year. In 2015, it was 22. So if those figures are correct, it's over 100% increase. But you know, I've got other resources that are talking about 70 elephants that are in less than a year, between May and December. So if that's the case, the elephant poaching in Kruger is taking the same trajectory as what's happened with the rhinos 2008, 2009, and 2010. And we probably will see well over 100 elephants poached this year, if not over 200, God forbid. But we also looked at this when we launched and got together to launch Now and Ever African Wildlife Trust. South Africa doesn't really have, and Johan can definitely tell you far more, but what I do know is that an elephant orphan that's very young, especially when they get diarrhea, is very, very difficult to turn around. And there isn't really the expertise and the skills and the manpower to look after the elephant orphan. So that's where we have to prepare ourselves simultaneously to save elephant orphans as well. Okay, so that's really it. But yeah, to add on to that, we definitely would look at, you know, saving a lion or, you know, other animals as well at the same time. So talking about impact conservation finance, which is a new terminology that has come to the forefront in the last few years, and I'm pleased to have Tariku Bukhale here today, who is a young gentleman that has disrupted his life by spending a lot of money creating a fictional movie, the first fictional movie on the rhino poaching crisis that South Africa has. Tariku has, I'm going to give over to Pete. If you want to grab a mic, you can carry on more with and give us the thing. But Tariku has is our first sort of donor in terms of impact conservation finance, where he's decided that he wants Now and Ever African Wildlife Trust to benefit. So Pete, over to you. Pete, by the way, is also director of the Rhino Orphanage.
Thank you. Thank you, Dex. Thank you, Tim. It's always inspiring to be here on days like this. I'm linked to the Now and Ever African Wildlife Trust through my work raising funds for the Rhino Orphanage. My job, and I'm very proud of it, is to raise money from people. And one of my things going forward will be to raise as much money as I can for the Now and Ever African Wildlife Trust, which is, I believe in passionately. I met Tariku when he came to the Rhino Orphanage with the bizarre request, could we film a feature film at the Rhino Orphanage? The answer was no, because it's a conservation project. We don't let members of the public in. But the directors and the the guys on the crew were very nice. They said they wouldn't disrupt the rhinos. We had a meeting in advance, and actually, we thought actually it might actually be, it's a great idea if they don't disrupt the rhinos, which they didn't. They filmed at the Rhino Orphanage. Harry was present to make sure they behaved themselves. Tirico was armed with an AK-47 at the time, so we all had to behave ourselves as well. He told us it wasn't a real one, but I'm not so sure. I thought Tirico was the, embarrassingly, I thought he was the security guard on the film shoot. It turned out he's the producer and the brains behind the film. We got together recently, and Tirico has agreed global revenues from the film, which will be released later this year, will be donated. 10% of global revenues will be donated to the Now and Ever African Wildlife Trust. We're targeting between $1 and $2 million as that revenue. As I said, as Dex said, this is the first feature film ever to focus on poaching of a large animal, in this case rhinos. So we have a very short clip, which we'll show in a second. The clip links directly into some educational conservation work we did with the guys from Unearth who were sat here, who were brilliant people. We took Tirico, dressed in his full gear from the film, up into two rural communities in Limpopo to use film as a conservation education tool. So use a fictional film as a conservation education tool.
All the men captured are Al-Qaeda operatives. There's reason to believe that they're funding their terror campaigns with ivory and rhino horns.
What do you need me to do?
Get you all the fever shots.
Tell my good friend that once the ban on trade is lifted, we're both going to be very rich.
Do not do this.
Al-Qaeda in the bush?
Black Mamba, the most dangerous snake in the world.
I got out all the bullets except one.
Gabriel! Gabriel!
Kills you quickly.
Very quickly.
Can you give us as candidates?
You must love your school and look after your school, look after your communities, and read books as much as you can.
Black Mamba, the most dangerous snake in the world.
I got out all the bullets except one.
You need to go back and educate the elders that are out there in the communities. We need to teach people all over Africa, not only in South Africa, but especially here, why we need to save rhinos, why we need to save elephants. Rhinos need to be saved because from a tourism point of view, it brings people from overseas. It generates jobs.
We were there 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, up at those rural schools. Something that's being discounted is that virtually, I would say 60-70% of them, if not more, have cell phones and are on social media. And when I asked them, who of you been into the park, the answer was zero out of nearly 500 kids at two schools. And I know Unearth is working on a program that we're going to, you know, assist with to take some of these kids in to Kruger, where they can actually participate in a game drive and see these animals. But this is obviously the big problem. How do you, you know, if you don't change the hearts and minds of 5-6 million people living west of Kruger National Park, you just have to look at Google Earth from Malalan to Nelspruit all the way up past to Palabora and see how many million people there are. That and there's wealth as well. I mean, flying over there, there's areas where there's 20 million rand houses next to squatter houses. It's amazing. You know, especially between Kruger and between Nelspruit and White River, there's areas where there's 20 million rand houses built in squatter areas. It's amazing. And I've got photos to prove that. But with these kids, you have to bring in the education side as well. And unless you, and this is also a program that we'd like to look at, to see how do we involve them, because they all have, so, you know, Fortunate was there with them, and they all tagged them, and they're on social media, and they take the pictures. So there's a dormant marketing tool lying next to Kruger National Park, as far as I'm concerned, that can be used.
I'm Leslie Stones, I'm covering this for Business Day. You've all been doing this all along anyway. I don't actually get what's new. What's the point of now giving it another name on top of all the names that you've already got and saying we're now working together? What is it in a nutshell that's actually changing now?
We've just been to the US for 3 weeks and interacting with funders from the West Coast to the East Coast, and it was surprising to see the positive reaction from funders, because there are lots of NGOs out there doing rhino work, and a lot of the money never gets to them, never gets to the ground. It gets filtered away. And they were really keen that we could put our politics aside, if there was any, and that we could come as a unified organization to focus on saving rhino with some very clear objectives. And I found that very interesting. So I, you know, that's the reason why we got together. And our biggest, South Africa, we raise funding. The corporate world is really supporting us, and private individuals are supporting. But to the scale that we're at the moment, if you see what cash we're burning to save rhinos at the moment, the market doesn't allow it yet. So we've had to move across borders into places like the US to actually raise the funding required. So that's the one reason that we work together instead of working in isolation. They see us. The other thing is that we've pooled our resources. We've put together a set of rules that we work to, which also excites the funders. That there's certain standards that we adhere to, and that we're trying to achieve best practices and so forth.
And how much money do you need to run this?
Sorry. We'll give you an example. To run Care for Wild, which has, I can't give you the number of orphans, but there are a large number of orphans. And our biggest cost is security. It's no use saving an animal, spending, for example, 260,000 rand a month on a helicopter, and you might spend 50,000 on a sortie to fetch the animal, bring it in. The vet bills could run to hundreds of thousands, depending on how damaged that animal is. And then you lose the animal. So our biggest cash burn in our situation is security, and then of course the feeding component. So we spend between half a million and 600,000 a month to run that orphanage.
So to add in terms of aviation, obviously if you charter a plane, you're going to pay the owner a retail price. Whereas if one can raise the funds, you can get a second-hand Bell helicopter that will fit, correct me if I'm wrong, but roughly $400,000. $400,000 to $500,000 for a second-hand, don't need new. It needs to be able to carry the weight. So a chopper is about $500,000. So the ideal is, in the South African context, to buy it with a rand, because, you know, as from I'm looking at it from a business point of view, the rand doesn't stabilize. So even if you buy it at 13 to 1, if you keep the chopper and use it for 4 years and at 17 to 1, it retains its value. It's a dollar-based asset, but that is also where your costs are drastically reduced if you have your own employed pilots and your own helicopter in the hotspots that can Tsavo them out, because speed is obviously of the importance. And then, like Chris said, it's the network. All of us have a huge network, and it's working those networks combined in various areas, whether it's the medical treatment, because Johan obviously doesn't work on his own in terms of the medicine, in the medicine field. He's got a huge base to avail himself, because Johan can't do a Rhino in Free State and one in Kruger at the same day. So it's a whole pooling of the resources, and I think funders from international would also like to see that this is, you know, they are, like Chris said, there's hundreds of Rhino organizations out there. And if you look at each website of the NGOs here, you can see photographic evidence of the real work that is being done on a day-to-day, week-to-week, month-to-month basis with everybody. So, you know, you can break one match, but it's very difficult to break a box of matches. Working together is much better.
And your first goal is to buy a helicopter, is it?
Pretty much to aim to first lease and then ideally to buy.
Ma'am, I just want to say something, just a bit on my background, and this is very interesting. The whole poaching and rhino rescues and so on developed from 2008. And I've seen the whole scope from being a captain in police, and then you do training and chemical capture, and then move over, work with veterinarians, and then eventually, so as this developed, I saw it's not only rescue, it's rescue, treatment, care, rehabilitation, conservation, research, and this line carries on to save the species. So saying this, if we do not work together, you can't be everywhere. And so this is where I also enjoy phoning and say to the people in the Kruger or to the people in Limpopo and Northwest, this is where you guys are, just have our back there and we can carry on here. So by doing this, we can save much more animals. And eventually, if we look at the genetics as well, eventually, why are we doing this? These animals, and this different strongholds and the different intensive protection zones, we want to save this species, so we need to stand together.
You know, maybe I could just come in there on a short, but currently we're losing about 1,000 rhino a year. I mean, we all know that for the last 4 years. So we're losing 1,000 rhino a year of a species that we know from a veterinary perspective, actually very little, okay? We don't know its anatomy, we don't know its physiology. When a small orphan actually gets diarrhea, we're not 100% sure how to treat that. Now I'm not even talking about elephant, okay? If we get 10 rhino orphans, we will probably, you know, save 9 of them. If you get 10 elephant orphans, doesn't matter what you do, you will probably only save 5, if you're lucky. Okay, so from a veterinary perspective, there's so little that we know about a species that we lose 1,000 a year. Okay, if you break your arm and you go to a medical doctor, he knows exactly where your blood vessels runs, where your nerve runs, how your bone actually looks if he wants to plate that. We know nothing about that. So me, you know, trying to save an animal with diarrhea, and I want to, you know, run blood tests to test enzymes and white blood cells and red blood cells, we don't have a clue what we're looking at. We go, I suppose that looks okay. If we compare that to a horse, I suppose that's okay. Because we compare the rhino a lot to the horse, because we think they're kind of the same. Well, over the last year, we've actually found out a rhino is not a horse. There are small ooreenkomste, all right? But there's massive differences between a rhino and a horse. And we don't know these things. As we go along, it's work in progress, and we actually find that out by making mistakes. So we also losing animals, which we shouldn't be losing because we don't know anything about this animal. So there's a massive amount of research that needs to be done on a species which we lose 1,000 a year. For instance, we don't know which antibiotics to give them, at which dosage, and for how long. You know, does it work, does it not work? Anti-inflammatories, painkillers on all these orphans and, you know, almost animals like Hope with these massive injuries. We don't know what painkillers to give them. You know, does it work a day? Does it work a week? Does it work 2 days? You know, does it work at all? We don't know. So we need to actually combine resources so that I can go to, you know, Petronel and to Uri and say, well, you guys have got 10 orphans. You've got 10 orphans. We need to run drug studies on your orphans, antibiotics, anti-inflammatories, so that we know how these drugs, you know, perform in the body of a rhino. I need to come to you to take radiographs. A stupid thing as radiographs. I need to take radiographs from when a baby is 1 month old to when it is 12 months old, just to see how the actual bone structure develops. We don't even know that. I get many x-rays, you know, from people in the rest of Africa saying, is this normal for a 3 month old rhino? I don't know, because it's never been published, it's never been researched. So that's why we also need to pool resources and work together to be able to save one species.
Sorry, I just want to say something else. Don't stare that we're looking just to get a helicopter to do rescues. Now and ever has got a good vision going forward. So what's happening out in South Africa with private landowners, we're not talking St. Parks, we're talking private landowners. Many landowners are out there, they're working in isolation. And is it working at the moment? Are we able to protect rhino? We're not, we're losing the game. Definitely. So Now and Never has put together a set of rules and documents and best practices, and we aim to test those at Care for Wild, which will grow land to more than 50,000 hectares, and then at Uri's area, which is I think 45,000 hectares already, or 30, how big is your area, Uri? 30?
28.
28, but it's going to grow. The idea is to replicate a rhino stronghold on private land. So Now and Never, the first step we're doing is rescuing these animals with a helicopter, is to grow this organization, to raise the funding, to be able to support those private landowners that don't have the means to raise cash, and that actually guide them in the right way, so that we actually develop 10 of these. So we aim to have 10 strongholds equal to what we're doing at the moment across South Africa, and for that matter, East Africa. And at the end of the day, if we can have 1,000 rhino in a stronghold that are safe, because the way we're doing security at the moment is also failing. Everybody's doing their own thing on a small scale. There's no overarching working together, and we see it differently. Our security is based on layers, from crime intelligence all the way through to rhino people that monitor the rhinos on a daily basis and how we respond, and having a helicopter and all that. Private individuals cannot afford that. There's maybe one individual in South Africa, if you use John Hume, for example, who burns $4 million a month just on security. We need to be able to build this organization so we can support those private landowners out there, that we can save rhinos. Because at the end of the day, we cannot lose this species on our watch, pretty much.
Thomas, any comments from your side on the global perspective?
Yes, I definitely can also provide some perspective on the question. So I think what has been said pretty much goes exactly into the direction why we have thought already a couple of years ago that we need to step up the game. We personally have seen that there are many, many fantastic organizations, there are fantastic individuals that are doing an impact every day, they're saving lives every day. Some of the most inspirational people you're seeing right now in front of you. But if we think about the poaching figures, if we think about the poaching crisis, if you think about the development of the full problem, we need to acknowledge that we're still far away from the solution. and has been, that it's not a matter of that we don't have many people or enough people to care about that want to make a change. It has been more that these people are not working closely with each other. If we really want to make a substantial change, we need to step up the game. And we need to get the right people on the table, work together in order to really save them all. And that's exactly what never is. If we think about the figures which has been quoted today, we have at this point, if we think about 1,000 dead rhinos, we also know that we talk about a couple of 100, 200, 300 orphans which are affected by this every year. We are saving right now probably 10, 20%. But thinking about the people that we have on the ground, think about the project that we have on the ground, think about the different parts of the chain that we already represent, we definitely can save them all. And now and ever is one of the first big initiatives to get all the right people in this space together, to ensure that we work together, to ensure that we make projects happen, which will be too big for each of the individual organizations, but which will be exactly the right scale if we get the right people involved. So the helicopter, as mentioned by Chris, is probably one of the first things that will kick up, but it's definitely not the last. There are various things which we want to approach, there are various things which we want to solve. In the end, we have a very, very clear goal and mission here, and this is to save them all. And the only way to do that is by uniting the best people that we have on the ground. And this is, in my opinion, the main goal of this initiative.
The other thing I want to ask is there are about 300 to 400 rhino NGOs working in South Africa. Are you going to try and get them to work with you, or because you know it's just so much work being duplicated?
Certainly, I think Elise, when it comes to Tula Tula, for instance, as an orphanage or the other orphanages, we like to see the support locally as well as internationally where we can bring them into the fold as such. So, you know, the board would have a look at the work that they do, and it has to be pretty much on the ground work like Tula Tula does, because we all know Karen, for instance, here. So, but we first, you know, we first got to walk before we can run, before we can fly.
Elise, but I must say, and this is for me very important actually to say, we're already phoning each other, like I know two or three others that will say, listen, how are you doing this? You know, there was a little one at Morlu, there's one in Northern Cape, we're now helping Johan Huber and them in the Eastern Cape, Shamwari. So that's already maybe not that official, but on a call, yeah, definitely. Coming visit each other and so on.
Morning, Bonadabot from the documentary film Stroop. Will you have any lobbying aspects towards government, for example, on domestic trade? And secondly, if the previously mentioned government controls on orphanages come into place, how will you lobby that?
I think on Now Never doesn't want to get involved in the politics as such. It has polarized the South African community in many ways. My NGO, Youth for African Wildlife, myself personally, has been very vocal and against the trade. What Now or Never wants to, we'll certainly lobby the government in terms of working with Sandparks, which we already do through with Kruger and that. But I think it's a dangerous game to play to get for Now or Never that wants to do the absolute scientific work, the rehabilitation work, the rescue work, and preferably to stay out of that, because every NGO that's here might have an opinion on you know trade as such, but we don't want to convolute all our efforts, which is really rescue, rehabilitate, release, and educate.
And then just the second question about the previously mentioned government controls on orphanages. If that comes into place, how will you lobby that?
I think we've taken the bold step and we've actually set up a whole set of rules on how they should be run. And we've been very bold with Kruger and with Deer, and actually those have been sent to them from our side. So in terms of rehabilitation and how they should be run, how orphans should be handled, how they should be reintroduced back into the wild, we've actually written up documents specifically on that. So we definitely will make sure that from our side that we, that whatever's promulgated, if or whatever's the rules become, is that they are practically workable and that they're actually in the interest of Rhino at the end of the day, not anything else.
There is a lot of politics in conservation, not only in proper politics. We do what we do for government reserves free of charge. Absolutely free of charge, the Rhino Orphanage. And I just sometimes get the feeling that they don't really appreciate it all that much at times. But over the past couple of years, we've had very, very good relationships with government from the side of the Rhino Orphanage. I can't speak for Chris and Peter and Al. They right next to Kruger, so they handle all the Kruger calves. We are on the other side of the mountain, so we handle more of Northwest Parks calves and Limpopo Province calves. And we really got a very, very good relationship with Northwest Parks as well as Limpopo Parks. And we just need a bit more commitment from central government. That will help a lot.
Well, the comment from Careful Outside is that we've got a very clear MOU with Sandparks. It's signed. Sandparks support us. They give us all the support. We work closely with them. We have a very set pattern that we work with them. We get a few calves from Mpumalanga Parks Board, and they do support us. But a majority of the animals that come through Care for Wild are Sandparks animals, and that MOU is in place. It's well defined. We get support from Sandparks, and then we supply support through our funding. So, you know, it's just the way it is.
If you do the maths, if we're losing 1,000 rhino a year, and you might be able to save 300 calves, I don't see why you're confident you can save the species. You just, if things don't change in the poaching scale, you're just delaying the inevitable, aren't you? Why are you confident you can save?
If I can answer that, if you save one calf, you must ensure that the calf is not going to get poached. And as I said, Now or Never doesn't support what happened in the past in terms of how anti-poaching's done. Anti-poaching in South Africa, a lot of it, is reacting to a carcass. That's what it is at the moment. We have a totally different view on how we approach it as an organization. And so if we save 200 calves, then our objective is to have zero poaching. So 200 calves means that those calves will grow up, and if there's another 50 calves and so forth, natural mortality will happen. But for us, our objective is very clear: zero poaching on anything that we're involved with. And I believe that you can do that. It costs money. At the moment, we believe that you should have a Mark IV eyeball on every rhino 24/7, day and night. And it's working in places like the parts of Zim, where they've got the same process, where they a lot of job creation, they train people and they follow the rhino around, and then you've got a very good reaction team that responds to that. Your boundary fence has to be up to standard. You have to have tracking dogs. You patrol the fences. We do all that. So to answer you directly, are we going to have one of our rhino poached? We had one poached right in the beginning when we started. We learned massive lessons. We arrested all those people within 9 days. They're awaiting trial. Sure. But we don't intend losing one rhino. That's our objective.
Does that answer your question?
I just want to add, young player saved the wild rhino, and it was 60 rhino, and we're already there in just what we're busy with, the animals that we're busy with working on. He saved it from extinction, young player.
If I can add also, in certain respects, sometimes the research, and I know the media is bombarded with work on so many levels of investigations and so forth. But one also has to look. I mean, yesterday you see this thing, there's a rhino poacher that got 77 years, 2 years ago, which 40 years was suspended, which
they at the time on conviction, because at the time government would brag about the guy 77 years, but 40 years were suspended. And it was a hectic sentence because he also got found guilty of murder, so he was given a big sentence on the murder. He's out on bail for 15,000 rand, $1,200. He was out on bail. He was sentenced in 2014 and he's out on bail. So, you know, this is where media can assist and support to say, to have that more, which is pressure on governments. Because, like I said earlier, like Ari said also earlier, unless, and it's a global shift that needs to take place, you know, the global wildlife crime is way over $20 billion a year. There has to be a shift in, not only in South Africa, that shift has to take place in Asia, it has to take place, you know, United Kingdom, for instance, at the moment, is still boxing in Parliament whether they should put a ban on certain ivory trades or not, whereas China has taken the lead and said by the end of the year they'll ban the ivory trade. America has put in a near total ban as such. It's a global thing. We are only one tiny cog in the wheel of all of this, but there has to be a thing, a change in ethics, there's got to be a change in patriarchal attitudes around the world which is decimating the wildlife. I don't see 100 women jumping on planes with 3.5 acres and coming to hunt in Africa, you know. So there's so many facets of it, and we're just saying, well, if we can add our value, somebody else can add their value on a government level or another NGO's level as well. And also understand, the big NGOs, I mean, there's some of these NGOs that rake in $300 million a year plus. Lots and lots of those that take place. As an NGO, we don't draw salaries from us now and ever, puts everything back. And in fact, we put, you know, Chris and I are business people, we've put our time in. Jan's a scientist, Ari's an educational person that's been involved in the conservation world, and Petronelle's also in conservation for many, many years. It's a passion that we put in, because if we can make a difference, somebody else around the corner can also make a difference. Collectively, it has to be done.
Whatever we start, it's mammoth. It's not easy, it's a massive task, but I definitely don't start something that I fail on. And I will ensure that Care for Wild will be sustainable. So that there's a point when the funders dry up, and then it must be sustainable. And there's many options out there, many opportunities, and that's what we need to be guiding ourselves down. Because at the end of the day, somewhere along the line, you have to stand alone, and you have to stand on your own 2 feet and be able to pay for those rhinos, or whatever the process is. That's clear. Sustainability is number one in the future.
I just want to get clarity. When you say the rhinos will go back into the wild, I know you mentioned 10 safe havens across Africa. Does this mean reserves with other animals, like where they came from? Or are we talking about a farm, like focusing on breeding specifically, like a rhino breeding farm?
No, they're not. Definitely not. No, it'll be a natural habitat where rhino occur with whatever else occurred in that area naturally. So it'll be buffalo, lion, elephant. It'll be in a natural system.
Yeah, we currently already have, you've got about 6,000 hectares.
We've got six, and we have a planned 85, growth to about 85,000 potentially.
Okay.
Funding dependent on being able to put the fences up and then translocate animals back into some of those areas. There's already all the common occurring species occur there. So it's a natural system.
And then also, Ari, you're sitting on 27,000 hectares. We've got in the pipeline people that would apply. There's 24,000 hectares on a Tuli block in Botswana. There's potential also in the Tsavo, that's 42,000 hectares. We've just got to sort Massengura. And, you know, potential others as well. So it's totally where it would thrive with other animals in tourism related, in most of these will be tourism related. So no breeding, natural breeding, no free roaming, like as if they were where they came from.
I do want to follow up on one of your questions, Bonnet, the domestic trade issue. Susan Scott from Stroop. I think in our time filming, that's been the most divisive issue, has been the trade, domestic trade. So I would love to know, when you've got vets or organizations working with you, and I'm not mentioning names here, who maybe don't believe in domestic trade, and you're bundled as one organization representing five NGOs, and you save a survivor and it goes to a facility that maybe is now all of a sudden in a year, 2 years' time, trading domestically, if the DA go ahead with what looks like is going to happen, how will you, because that's been our experience, it is the issue that's dividing all of us, and it's what's not letting us go forward because of that. Mm-hmm. Do you have plans to sort of, go, okay, despite our differences, we still move forward?
To answer from Care for Wild side is 90% of our animals are owned by the state. So we have no Care for Wild policy other than whatever the state policy is. And at the moment, it's no trade. That's what it is. So we have no choice. The animals belong to the state. So that's pretty much where we stand. That's where we are at the moment. And that's where we are. And we would definitely, that's not going to change.
Sure, Chris, but I think if in a year, 2 years' time, in terms of legislation, but if suddenly state is trading...
I'm not prepared to no, comment no, on that. And the reason is the animals belong to the state. Those animals are state-owned animals. So at the moment, it's no trade, and that's our position. You can see on the website.
No, absolutely.
In two or 3 years' time, at the moment, I don't think it's even point to debate.
We'll also one's got to look. So rhinos that get released, for instance, ledger, that's a tourism destination, and there's no cutting off the horns on that side. Looking at Tuli Block and Botswana, there's proper Botswana Defence Force, for instance, assist. There's also no harvesting of the horn on that side as well. It's going to be interesting. I mean, obviously all the objections went in, globally last Friday and were submitted. So now we've got to adopt a wait and see situation because those RAF regulations had lots of flaws in it that I looked at. But I think people like Johan, I don't think Johan's got the time to look at that. Where's he going to find the time to read those? And same with Petronel. So,
do they have horns?
If at the end of the day, what each NGO does underneath it is, there might be differences of opinion or things like that. I'm certainly not going to argue with Johan, for instance, if he says a rhino's got to be put down, it's got to be saved, I'm not going to argue with him. That's his choice, that's his expertise. As such, so it's an interesting, concept where it's going to go. As you know, I've been very much on the forefront for a number of years, boxing against trade, because I don't think it's going to work. The numbers are just not, can't add up. But we, from now on ever, it's let's rescue them, let's rehabilitate them, let's release them. And let's also educate, let's not forget the education part of rural Africa as such. That is so, so, so necessary.